Let's look at this in Genesis chapter 27, verse 46. In verse 46, it says, "And Rachel said to Isaac, I am weary of my life because of the daughters of Heth. If Jacob take a wife of the daughters of Heth, such as these which are of the daughters of the land, what good shall my life do me?" Worry and anxiety. Let me give you the background. Actually, what happened is when Rebecca was pregnant and she was having some problem carrying the pregnancy, she went to God in prayer. And as she went to God in prayer, the Lord said, "Don't worry, you're going to bear twins. The older one will be Esau and the younger one will be Jacob. But I'm telling you now, I've seen their future. The younger one, Jacob, will be much blessed above Esau, the firstborn." And then Rebecca held that those children were born. And now the children began to grow up. And then Isaac himself, worry and anxiety. He said, "I'm getting old. Therefore, Esau, come, go to the field and go and catch whatever you can hunt. And then make me some food so that my soul will bless you before I die." Isaac did not die even for the next 20 years. Because you see, Jacob went out. 7 years he spent for Leah. 7 years for Rachel. And 6 years he served Laban. 20 years. When he came back, Isaac was still alive. But the worry and the anxiety, "I don't know when I will die." Why are you worried about that? Don't worry about your life. Everything is in the hand of God. And now when Isaac said, "Go and bring me something to eat, then I will bless you," then Rebecca remembered that Jacob shall have the blessing, that it is not Esau. And therefore she quickly did something. That's worry. That's anxiety. Rebecca did not have to do that. And then eventually after they did what they did, then Isaac blessed Jacob. Esau came and said, "My father, bless me. Where are you coming from? Who is the one that gave me venison and I ate?" And then he realized it's Jacob. And now another problem arose. The problem is that Esau threatened, "I will kill Jacob." Again, Rebecca went into worry and anxiety. And so she went to Isaac, the father of Esau and Jacob, and said, "What good will my life do me? Leave it in the hands of God. He careth for you." Since God has said that this Jacob will become great, how can he allow Esau to kill him? The promise is there already. Rely on the promise of God. And eventually, she convinced Isaac, and then they sent away Jacob. Before Jacob came back, the mother had died. You see, that's worry and anxiety. We don't have to touch any of these things. Let God work everything out. And eventually now, at last, when he came back, the mother was not there and Isaac was still alive. And Rebecca said, "Go just for a few days until the anger of Esau will cool down." 20 years, the anger of Esau did not cool down. And then, what did Jacob do? I said, what did Jacob do? He prayed. He could have prayed before he ran away. You don't need to run away. Just stay there and pray. After 20, it took him 20 years to learn that we cast all our cares upon the Lord. He could have prayed without running away. And then he will enjoy the fellowship of the mother and of the father and of the brother Esau. And what God did 20 years after, he could have done at the time he ran away. Worry and anxiety will not help us. You will not worry again. Look at Ruth, the result of worry and anxiety. Ruth chapter 1. In Ruth chapter 1, we're reading from verse 1. Ruth chapter 1. Verse 1, "Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons." Why? Worry and anxiety, there is famine. What are we going to eat? My brother, the other people too that are not running away, what are they going to eat? Don't you think about that? The famine is not only on you. The problem is not only on you. All the other people too, they have the same problem. If they are staying, why don't you stay? But this man of Bethlehem, Judah, he just ran away because of the famine. No prayer, no seeking the face of the Lord. That's what worry and anxiety does in verse 2. And the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the name of his two sons Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continued there. And then we're told in verse 3, Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died. You will not die in a strange land. You know that's what kills the people, worry and anxiety. You know about the people that remain at home. They went through the famine. They went through the difficulty. Whatever time we're going through, you will go through. Nothing will destroy your life. But it's when anxiety comes, when worry comes, then we take a decision. And then we uproot ourselves, and then we go where the Lord has not sent us. And then we're told, and she was left and her two sons. And they took them wives of the women of Moab. And the name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. And they dwelt there about 10 years. And Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them. Why didn't you stay at home, Elimelech? Then you preserve your life. And these innocent children, you preserve their lives. But you know, running helter-skelter, because of worry, because of anxiety. What are we going to eat? Where with us shall we be clothed? There is famine. There is no job. There is no sustenance. Let me take care of myself. Cast all your cares upon him. And then in verse 6, then she arose with her daughters-in-law, that she might return from the country of Moab. For she had heard in the country of Moab how that the Lord had visited his people in giving them bread. Oh, she said, we ran away because there was no food. Now we're hearing information. The place we ran away from, God has provided food there. If you remain in the kingdom, every good thing you need will come to you there. But you know, before she learned the lesson, husband gone, two sons gone, and then one daughter-in-law, Orpah, also stayed behind, and she came back with just one daughter-in-law. And then look at verse 20. Verse 20, and she said unto them, call me not Naomi, call me Mara, call me bitterness, for the Almighty has dealt bitterly with me. That's because of worry and because of anxiety. Let's remember that we're to cast our cares all upon the Lord. If we cast our cares upon the Lord, he's caring for the birds, he will care for us. And then we're looking at Matthew chapter 10, we're looking at verse 29. Matthew chapter 10, verse 29. Are not two sparrows sold for a farthing? And one of them shall not fall on the ground without your father, without the knowledge and the consent of your father. But the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do you know the number? I said, do you know the number? No, but God knows the number. And he says, he'll not even allow, no enemy will be able to pluck even a strain of air from you. If that is so, if the worthless air God is taking care of, and he has counted them, and he said, none shall fall to the ground without his consent. How about your very life, your soul, your body, your mind, your job, your wife, your husband, your children? God will take care of everyone. That's why he's telling us then, but your very ears, the very ears of your head are all numbered. Fear ye not, therefore, ye are of more value than many sparrows. We come to point number 3 now. Point number 3, consistent confidence of faith without anxiety. Confidence in the Lord without fear, without anxiety, without worry. Matthew chapter 6, reading from verse 28. And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field. Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. Yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed, was not clothed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Worry is essentially distrust of God. When somebody is worried, anxious, it's like it's not believing in God. He believes in God for salvation, but for the other little things in life, he's doubting God. He's distrusting God. Faith in God sets us free from worry and anxiety. When you have faith in God, and you know that God will take care of you, and he will take care of you. If God fails, you'll be the first person out of many, many people, millions of people, over many thousands of years, you'll be the first person that God will fail in his case. If God has not failed, all the people that live before you and all the people who are living today, will God fail you? He will not fail you. He will take care of you. And so when people have doubt, unbelief, that's when they get into worry, into anxiety. He who believes in God will not worry. He who believes in God will not be anxious, because he believes in the love of God. It is pointless to worry. Can worry and anxiety add 1 cubit to our stature? You are worrying. By worrying, you become taller. By worrying, do you live longer? No, by worrying, you live, you cut your life short. People who worry a lot, they die prematurely. People who worry a lot, they get into problems that they shouldn't have gotten into. That's what it says in this Matthew chapter 6. Look at it, Matthew chapter 6, verse 27. Which of you, by taking thought, by worrying, by being anxious, can add 1 cubit to your stature? Can we find a man in the Bible that added more than 1 cubit to his stature? Can we find a man in the Bible that added more than 1 year to his lifespan? Yes, we can. Look at 2 Kings chapter 20. 2 Kings chapter 20. We're reading from verse 1. In those days was Hezekiah sick unto death. And the prophet Isaiah, the prophet son of Amos, came to him and said unto him, thus says the Lord, set your house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. Now if the man started worrying, if the man started being anxious and started troubling himself, cannot sleep, he will still die. Because by worry and anxiety, you cannot add 1 cubit to your stature. But instead of having worry and anxiety, he had faith. And he prayed. If you can pray, this situation will change. All these circumstances will change. Prayer will do something that worry cannot do, that anxiety cannot do. It is prayer, it is faith that adds more than 1 cubit to our stature. And then he turned his face to the wall and he prayed unto the Lord, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember now how I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart. And then he says, and I've done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept so. And it came to pass before Isaiah was gone out into the middle court, that the word of the Lord came to him, saying, turn again and tell Hezekiah, the captain of my people, thus says the Lord, the God of David thy father, I have heard thy prayers. I have heard thy prayer. Do you know tonight God has heard your prayer? All those concerns, all those cares, all the things you are bothered about, God says, the Spirit of God is telling you, God has answered your prayer. Don't worry, just pray. Don't be anxious, just pray. You know, some of our singers, they tell us, why worry when you can pray? You know, some other people, it is why pray when you can worry. But I will not worry. I said, I will not worry. If we can pray, look at a man like you, like me. He prayed and God added something to his life. God will add value to your life. I've heard thy prayer. I have seen thy tears. Behold, I will heal thee. That sickness will not kill you. It's not time for you to die yet. If you can pray and believe in the Lord and stop the worry and anxiety, all those problems, they will not drown your life. On the third day thou shalt go up unto the house of the Lord, And I will add unto thy days, how many years? 15 years. By worrying, nothing will be added. By prayer, 15 years were added unto this man. And that's what the Lord is telling us. And now, you see the people that worry, they get into extra problems, great, great problems. Let me show you an example. For Samuel chapter 27. For Samuel chapter 27. I'm reading from verse 1. Worry and anxiety instead of prayer. Worry and anxiety instead of leaning upon the Lord. Worry and anxiety instead of just saying, Lord, I'm in your hand. In 1 Samuel chapter 27 verse 1, David said in his heart, I shall now perish one day by the hand of Saul. It is surprising David could talk like that, because David had been anointed. He had been anointed king. Samuel said, you'll be king over the land of Israel. Jonathan said, I know you'll be king over Israel. And Saul also said, I know you will surely reign over Israel. Swear unto me that when you become a king, that you will not destroy my family. Samuel said so. Saul said so. And Jonathan said so. And he himself knew. In fact, the whole of Israel, they knew. That's what Abigail said. Abigail said, be careful, David. I know this man, Nabal, his name is a foolishness. And he has acting like his name. Don't do anything to him. So that when you become a king, everybody knew that David was going to become a king. The angels know the blessings on you. Almighty God knows what he has purposed for you. Jesus knows what he has ordained for you. And the Holy Ghost is bearing witness as to what you are going to become in life. But at the time of a problem, then we forget what the Father has said. We forget what Jesus has said. We forget what the Holy Ghost has said. We forget even some of our brothers and sisters, the testimonies they gave about us, and what the Lord revealed to them, that God is going to bless your life. David forgot everything, that he had been anointed king and he was going to reign. Now he said, one day I will perish, just die, out of the hand of Saul. Then in verse 1, there is nothing better for me than that I should speedily escape into the land of the Philistines. This chapter 27, in chapter 17, 10 chapters behind, is when he fought against Goliath, a Philistine. And now he went into the enemy camp because of discouragement, because of worry, because of anxiety. You know, anxiety and worry will just drive us here and there instead of being the king or the prince that you are, and a child of a king that you are, and just staying confidently, knowing God will take care of your life. But now he went to the land of the Philistines, and Saul shall despair of me and seek me anymore in any coast of Israel, so I shall escape out of his hand. And David arose, and he passed over with 600 men that were with him unto Achish, the son of Maok, the king of Gath. And I'm surprised none of those 600 men could talk to David to say, David, we know you're a leader. We know you're a king. Don't let us allow temporary problem to take us away from long life and lifelong promise of God. We are following you because we know God has appointed you to be a leader. How are we going to run to the enemy camp saying that we're afraid of anybody? In fact, I don't know why David should do something like this. And sometimes I don't know why you should do something like that when the protection of God is upon you. There was a time that Saul was looking for David. And there was a mountain. If you read in 1 Samuel, David was on this side and Saul was on this side. Just a few minutes, Saul would have caught David. And then immediately God sent a messenger from the house of Saul saying, there's a problem, so come. And then that's how Saul went away, and he went to face problem and left David alone. God had been protecting David, and God will still protect David. God has been protecting you, and God will still protect you. He has been providing for you. He will still provide for you. Why take this kind of step? Because of worry, because of anxiety. Today, anxiety is canceled. And then eventually, here is what happened now. And let us look at, this, David, the step that followed, verse 5. And David said unto Achish, if I have not found grace in thine eyes. David, I don't understand your language. Grace in the sight of a Philistine. Grace in the sight of the enemy of God. Let them give me a place in some town, in a country, that I may dwell there. For why should thy servant dwell in the royal city with thee? He dropped his crown. He said, you are a greater man than I am. You are a greater king than I am. I'm just an ordinary fellow. He lost his dignity, worry and anxiety. He said, why should I dwell and live in a royal city with you? Then Achish gave him Ziklag that day. Wherefore, Ziklag pertaineth unto the kings of Judah unto this day. Well, if you remember the story of Ziklag, those people came there and they just burnt everything down. And then David began to cry. And look at it in chapter 30. Chapter 30, it's from verse 1. And it came to pass when David and his men were come to Ziklag on the third day that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag and smitten Ziklag and burnt it with fire. And then we're told here in verse, look at verse 4, then David and the people that were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep. David, you know, the reason worry and anxiety. It's worry and anxiety that drove him and drove them out of the place of protection. If we stay under the shadow of the Almighty, nothing will harm us. We don't have to run to the Philistines or to Achish or to anybody. Where we are, the Lord will take care of us. That's why the Lord is telling us, don't be worried and don't be anxious. The Lord will take care. Let's look at Psalm 91. Psalm 91. Don't let us be running about, going here and going there, when the Lord has promised that he'll take care of us. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High, that's where I'm living.